comonads, currying, compose, and closures. This is the language of functional coders. Equational reasoning, tail recursion, lambdas and lenses, and effect aversion. Referential transparency and pure functions, pattern matching for ADT deconstructions. Functors, folds, functions that are first class, monoids and monads, it's all in the type class. Infinite lists, as long as they're lazy. Return an option, or just call it maybe. Polymorphism and those higher kinds, monad transformers, return and bind. Catamorphisms, like from category theory, could use an either type for your query. Arrows, applicatives, continuations, IO actions, and partial applications. Higher order functions and dependent types, bijection and bottom in a way that's polite. Programming of a much higher order can be found just around the jargon corner. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Katie Miller, also known as codemiller. And if you were wondering what language it was I was just speaking, and not just because of my funky Australian accent, then you're in the right session. Today I'm going to be trying to demystify some functional programmer lingo. Not all of the terms that I've mentioned, but at least a handful. I know from experience what it can be like to hear functional programmers blabbering on when you're unfamiliar with their lingo. So they're there chattering away about how amazing FP is and shooting out terms like generalized algebraic data type and catamorphism and category theory. And you're there feeling like a muggle, looking at them like, cata what now? I'm sorry to say that this session will not save you from that experience. If you go out afterwards and start learning more about FP, and I very much hope that you do, you will come across unfamiliar terms. What I want to hope to do today is to give a little bit of context to a few of the common ones at least, so that hopefully this jargon as a whole won't seem quite so intimidating. There are dozens and dozens of phrases that I could have chosen, even more than what made it into my poem, but I've just picked out seven terms that I think are worth knowing about. So I'm going to give a brief explanation of each one and a short code example accompanied by a picture, as promised, as well as a code snippet that uses that concept from a web app that I have running on OpenShift. So my mission today is to achieve two things. Firstly, I'd like to give you a sense that functional programming is useful, that these concepts are worth knowing about, because I genuinely believe that they are, especially given today's computing landscape. And secondly, that functional programming is accessible. This stuff is not actually rocket science, and with a little bit of effort, anyone can learn it. The terms might be unfamiliar, and it will take some work to learn what they really mean and how to apply them, but functional programming isn't scary. It's just a different way of thinking about computation, and I'd like to spark your interest to go out and learn a bit more about that. It is not my aim today to try to make anyone a functional programming expert or to give you a complete understanding of any of the terms covered. I only have about 4 minutes for each one, and I've done entire presentations on some of them, and I think they all probably warrant that. So today is really just about the high-level overview, the big idea of each topic, without just skimming over a whole bunch of the details. So I'd like to give you a general idea of what each thing is, where it fits in, and why you might care. If you want a deep understanding of any of these concepts, you're going to have to go out and do your homework and see and experience these things for yourself. That's really the only way that you'll come to understand them fully. Another caveat, I've included illustrations in the hope that it might help some to make sense of the code examples, and for entertainment value, of course. But like any analogy, there are going to be holes, so don't go too deep with them. And given I will be pushed to time today, I'd ask if you can please hold any questions till afterwards. I'm doing a signing of my book, Getting Started with OpenShift, at the O'Reilly table after this, so you can catch me there or just track me down around the conference. So before we move on to breaking down some jargon, there's a little bit of background material that I'd like to cover. So I'm going to be using the Haskell programming language in the talk today because it's a great language for expressing FP concepts. However, I want to stress that all of the concepts I'm going to be talking about can be applied across languages. These are functional programming concepts, not Haskell concepts. So to give me some idea, who's familiar with Haskell syntax? Are you a show of hands? Okay, a smattering, but not everyone. So for those that aren't, here's a bit of a quick primer to give you enough knowledge of the syntax to understand the rest of the talk. So here's an example, first of all, of setting a couple of variables. So list one and list two, and on the right-hand side of the equals there is some list syntax. Interesting thing to note here is that in Haskell, all these variables are immutable. So once you set them, list one, list two, are going to have these values for the rest of your program. So here's an example of some function application now. So the function is the plus plus in the middle, and in Haskell we have a lot of operators like that that are in fixed position and use punctuation and things rather than just letters. So this is append or concat and just concatenating the list together. And there's the result shown as a comment there. Comment is the double dashes. So here's another example of function application, but this time the function, which is a custom function I've defined called catcon, is in prefix position. So this is being applied to list one and list two. Note that there's no parentheses there, which you might have in many other languages. In Haskell, function application is just a space. And this catcon function is just doing the same as the above, but in the opposite order. So how would you define such a function? So here's an example of a function signature. So we have the name of the function, catcon, and then after the double colons, we have the arguments that it takes and what it returns. So just ignore those arrows for now and just look at the things we've got in the middle. So we've got a function here that takes two lists of int, and it's going to return a list of int. Now that's quite specific for something that's just appending lists together, so we can make that a little bit more general by doing something like this. So now, instead of talking about lists of int, we're talking about lists of A, where A is like a generic type. This could be an int or a string or whatever else. But it's not just any A. The bit before the big arrow there is what's called a type class. So you can think of this as a bit like an interface. So this is saying that we can take any A, where A is a member of the num type class, which defines some particular behavior that these A's must have. And so if we jump into GHCI, which is the Haskell REPL, and we ask for some information about this num, it will tell us that it's a class, and this is type class, not class in the kind of object-oriented sense. And you can see in red here, there's some operations, so these are things that we expect nums to be able to do, things like addition and multiplication. And then at the bottom there in orange, there are some instances of this type class. So if we were using, say, Java, it might look something like that. You could define some kind of interface that's representing that behavior. But this is still a little bit more specific than we really need for just appending lists together. So we can get rid of that and have a function signature, something like this, where we're now talking about any list of A. So that's the signature. What about the actual implementation? So here we have the name of the function, and then we've got XSY, so this is going to be the names of the arguments coming in. And then after the equal sign, the actual body of the function, so we're just doing our append, but in the opposite order. So that's the whirlwind tour, but hopefully it'll just give you enough to grasp what's to come. So when people do talks about functional programming and they use pictures, obviously you need some kind of picture to represent a function, and often you get something like this, a box mapping inputs to outputs. But I promised in my abstract friendly pictures, so I give you the friendly funky snail who is going to be representing functions for us today. So friendly funky snail has a name there and potentially likes to eat some different things. So here we have two packets of ints, two lists of ints if you like, and if friendly funky snail eats those up, there's some kind of result. We're not going to think too closely about exactly how that happens. Funky is a magic snail. So another thing you might want to know about your snail is what kind of things it likes to eat. So some of our funky examples are going to have something on their shell that tells us, so this function, or this funky snail, likes to eat two packets of ints, and that'll give you back a packet of ints. Or if we are going to do something a little bit more generic, like we saw on the previous slide, we can say that he likes to eat two packets of whatever, and then it'll give you back a packet of that same whatever, where that whatever is certified as num. So that's the visual analogy that we'll have going for the rest of the talk. So I mentioned that I'm going to be showing a bit of a demo app that's hosted on OpenShift. OpenShift is an open source platform as a service by Red Hat. Basically, it allows you to worry about your code while it takes care of config, which is very useful when you're trying out an unfamiliar stack, such as perhaps a Haskell stack, when you're trying out your new functional programming skills. So the demo app that I'm going to be showing, I'm going to have a link to the repository at the end, and you can grab that and deploy it on OpenShift and play with it later if you like. So here's the demo app in question. So it's called Wubble or Word Bubble. So you choose what kind of word set you want and a number of bubbles. And then the idea is just to match the word that you see with the definition. So kind of simple little demo app. But this is, in fact, a full stack Haskell app in that the backend code, the HTML, the CSS, and the JavaScript were all written in Haskell. And the reason I've included this little demo app today is just to make the point that all these concepts we're going to look at, they're not just useful in theory, they come in handy all the time in real world kind of applications. So without any further ado, let's move on to the first term I want to talk about, which is referential transparency. So this is a property of expressions that you might find in your program that can be replaced with their value or result without changing the overall meaning or behavior of the program in any way. And to kind of see how this is useful and used, let's kind of recap first what functional programming is. So functional programming values immutable data and using pure mathematical style functions that simply map inputs to outputs. They don't do anything else. They don't have any other side effects. And when you have functions like this, so an expression that is calling a function like this with arguments that are referentially transparent, then that expression is going to be referentially transparent. And I'll show an example of that in a minute. So why code in this way? I think the big thing is because it enables us to reason about our code's behavior. In fact, we can even do equational reasoning on our code, like you might remember from, say, high school maths, when you know x equals 5, then you can then replace that x elsewhere in your expressions, that kind of thing. We can do that kind of reasoning on our code. And it also has the nice result that we can also do lazy evaluation with our code. So here's an example to make that a bit more concrete. Here is a very small but complete Haskell program. So in the first line, we're calculating what 2 plus 3 is, and then using the suck or successor function on that, so what's the next thing in the series. And then on the next line, we're doing a show, or like a toString of that result, and putting it to standard out with the put string line function there. So we can call this from the command line, and we're going to get the result, which you've probably figured out by now. So what's interesting about this is all these expressions here are referentially transparent. So if we take this suck to 2 plus 3, if we take that 2 plus 3 and replace it with its result, 5, this hasn't changed the behavior of our program in any way, because this was a referentially transparent expression. And we could do some of that equational reasoning. We can go, oh yeah, we know what a score is. We could substitute that in there. And again, no, there's no actual observable changes that come about from this. So we can reason about our code through this way. And so this is the kind of code we're looking to do. Now, of course, if that addition function was actually calling a database or writing something to standard out, then this wouldn't be true. But it's because we've written functions in this pure mathematical style way that we're able to reason like this. So here's a bit of a snippet of code from the Wubble app. So don't worry about all of this just yet. I'll kind of explain it progressively through the talk. But this is a little function that is helping us to decide where we're going to serve static files from. So we've got an environment variable with OpenShift in it there. So if the app is running on OpenShift, we're going to prepend something to our static path to tell it where we want to be serving files from. Otherwise, we'll be using something different because we're on localhost. So the thing that I want you to notice about this example at this stage is the return type. When you start talking about referential transparency and this kind of thing, people often say, oh, what about I/O? Like, how can you possibly do referentially transparent I/O? So what's actually happening here is we're not actually performing I/O in this function. The return type here is a description of some I/O that we want to occur. So this is like an I/O action or I/O computation. And the file path there is what's going to be returned, or what that computation is going to yield when it's actually complete. So some I/O action is going to occur, and after that, we're going to get a file path back. And by describing actions and making it very explicitly where I/O is going to occur, we can still reason about this code. It's referentially transparent, the same as all our other code in our program. And we leave the dirty part of actually doing the I/O. That's something that's the concern of whatever's actually going to end up interpreting this program. But from our point of view, we can still reason about this the same way, which is awesome. So the next area I want to talk about is higher order functions. So these are simply functions that take another function as an input or return one as a result, or they can do both. And this is really useful. I'm sure you've probably seen a lot of these around in your code, no matter what language it is that you do. So a kind of classic example is a map function for when we want to map some other function over a list. So wherever we see kind of common patterns, common recursion going on, or some kind of repeated code, we can often use a higher order function and have instead the little bit of logic that's changing each time passed in instead, rather than having a code with repetition in it. So this helps to reduce code repetition. So this is adhering to the dry or don't repeat yourself kind of principle. And it helps with gluing things together and helps make our code more modular. So let's have a look at an example. So now using GHCI, the REPL, so setting our list as before, now we can use this type command in GHCI to see actually what the type of something is. So I've mentioned the map function. What actually does it mean to map? What's its type? So this is telling us that map is a function which takes another function that takes some generic type A, int, string, whatever else, and returns some type B. And it takes a list of A's and gives us back a list of B's. So it's able to apply that function on everything in the list. So if we actually have a look at an example of that, so notice here, map on its shell actually likes to eat other snails. We have a carnivorous snail now, and this is because we're talking now about higher order. So if we map a lambda function here, so the slash here is the Haskell syntax for a little lambda. So this is a function being defined anonymously in line. Notice the picture, it doesn't actually have a name. Of some lm, and we return that lm multiplied by 2, and then when we apply that to a list, the result we're going to get is everything at list being multiplied by 2. And there are actually a number of higher order functions in this little example that we've seen already. I'm just going to draw attention to one. We have maybe here, which is a function that takes 3 arguments, and the second of those is actually another function. And this is defined using some Haskell syntax called sections. It's a little bit of syntactic sugar to write it a little bit more succinctly than we did on the previous slide with a lem. So you could just leave off one side of an infix function like this, and it knows to do like we had with a lem before. Next up, currying. So this is when we take functions that apparently have multiple arguments and turn them into a chain of functions that each take exactly one argument. So this is related to partial application, but distinct in that it's always exactly one argument that the function takes. Whereas when you're partially applying, you could pass, say, 2 functions to a 4-element function and get back a function that's waiting on the final 2. So I've kind of been lying to you a little bit up to this point when I've been talking about multiple argument functions in Haskell, because in truth, every single function in Haskell is curried. It only ever takes one argument. And this is useful for code reuse. So like those little lambdas we saw in the previous section, you can pass things around without having to actually worry about those kind of intermediate things you've got going on. It helps to make our code more readable, I think. So let's make this a bit concrete with an example. So here we have a catcon, like we had before, defined the same one way. But as I've said, this was kind of a bit of a lie. It really should look something like this. The reason being because the correct way to read the type signature at the top there is catcon is a function that takes a list of A and returns a function which takes a list of A, which then returns the list of A that we get at the end. And this is true of all the Haskell functions you'll see. So we can kind of check that out in GHCI by using this type command. So what's the type of taking catcon and giving it one argument? We know that it needs 2 before it actually gives us a result. It gives us a function. And so GHCI has told us, it's specified now that it knows that it needs to be some A that's in the num type class, and there's the function that we get back. We can take this further. We can do it with something like map. So if we take map and we give it that function we just got from the previous expression there, then the result of that is going to be a function which is now expecting a list of lists. It's been able to figure that out because of what we fed it so far, and then will give us back a list of lists. So if we actually now give it a list of lists and kind of step through logic of what's going on here. So we've got our catcon applied to one list. And when we do that, that's going to give us like an anonymous function that's expecting a list, which it's then going to use in the catcon expression there. So if we take map and give it that, then we get a function that's expecting a list of lists. And then if we finally give it that list of lists, that's when we actually get our final result. So just to be clear, I'm not saying this is exactly how the Haskell compiler would do it, but just to kind of reason through how this is actually working. So we end up with a bit of a snail conga line, if you like. So back to our example from before. So I mentioned earlier that maybe is a function that takes three arguments. Again, a little bit of a, and it's an approximation. So here are the arguments that it expects. That's its type. But actually in the above, we're only giving it two. So that's the first two of those. So what's the result of that expression? The result of that is a function. So, and the function is going to have the type that we see here. It's a function that takes some maybe file path. So maybe like it's like an option type, if you've heard of that. Maybe the value's there, maybe it's not. And then gives us back a file path. Next topic, closures. So closures are formed at runtime, and this is an instance of a function together with its referencing environment, the environment in which it was created. And this is very useful because it allows functions to access variables that were declared from their context or surrounding scope, even when that no longer exists at the time that is evaluated. And this is really useful for making our code more concise. So let's have a look at an example, again a GHCI. So I've defined this lambda here, and I'm saying it takes two things, which I've called ch and n. So the first one I'm expecting to be a character and the n to be an integer. And then it returns another function, a lambda here, that takes what I'm going to expect to be a string, str, and then it repeats that character. It creates the infinite list of repeating that character forever, but only takes the first n elements from that list and then appends the string to it. So if I apply this lambda to the arguments of the character a, 5, and aha, we get aha, so that times 5 with the ha appended on the end there. So if we just look at this lambda in the middle, so we've got our anonymous function that's expecting a list of characters or a string. We know it's getting in from our application here the string ha, but it's also using in its body an n and a ch. Where are those coming from? So it's as if when this is evaluated, it's like it took a snail selfie when it was actually created, and it's able to have a look in there and go, oh yeah, okay, ch, n, and grab out those values, so it's able to use that as well as this ha that's coming in to actually evaluate and give us the result that we're after. So here's a different little snippet from the app. So this is to do with game rendering the actual game. I'm not going to talk through everything that's going on here, but notice we've got this little lambda, and it's using three different variables here, ws, defs, and sdefs. Where are they coming from? So one's being passed into the lambda, one is coming from a lambda that's in the surrounding scope, and the ws you can't even see in the snippet that I've included. It's from the surrounding scope again. So if we had to be passing through all these things, you could imagine it would get quite messy, but thanks to lambdas, we get this much more succinct way. Thanks to closures, we get this much more succinct way of doing things. Okay, so let's get a little more abstract. Next up, I want to talk about functors. So functors are some kind of structure. Some people like to refer to it as a container, which is an analogy and only takes you so far, but you can think of it as a container if you like, that can be mapped over. So it's some kind of structure that contains other values, and we're able to map over those somehow to transform them without actually changing the shape of that structure that we're dealing with. I know that all sounds very abstract, but it'll hopefully become a little bit easier to see when we get to the examples. And so why is this useful? It's probably the big question you get when you start talking about these things to people who haven't really been exposed to functional programming so much. My answer to that is, you know, it's just a common pattern, and when we identify it, we're able to write things and we're able to abstract over things at another level, so we're able to avoid code duplication. I mean, that's what abstraction is great for, and that's pretty true, you know, of a lot of the things that you'll find in functional programming. These are all abstractions that enable us to avoid repeating ourselves because we can write things once for everything that fits that particular pattern. So if we jump into DHCI and use the info command to find out a little bit more about functor, it'll tell us that it's a type class. So this is like num was a type class, but it's a little different in that it's got this f here. So this is a type class that actually takes a parameter. And f here is actually a type constructor. So this is a constructor that needs another type to be given to it before it returns a concrete type. And to make that a little bit more concrete, list is an example of such a thing. So list by itself, that isn't really a type. You need to add, say, string or int, and then you have a concrete type. Ah, list of string, list of int. So f is something that fits that mold. And we also have so one real significant function here, which is called fmap. So if we want to imagine what this might look like if we wrote it, say, in Java, maybe we'd have an interface that looked like something like you see over the other side there. This actually wouldn't compile in Java, though, because if you see we've got this f of b thing going on and f of a, this is the part that won't compile, because we're saying we've got some generic type f, which itself takes a generic type. So we've kind of got two levels of things that are generic here. And in order for this to work, we need a type system feature called higher kind of types or higher order polymorphism, which Java unfortunately does not have. But in Haskell, we're able to express this just fine. So to kind of go back and have a look at it pictorially. So imagine we've got this container, if we like, or this structure that itself has other values in it that can be of whatever type. So that structure could be, say, a list. That's an example of that. So a list of some generic other type. It could be, say, IO. So we could have some IO action that returns some other type. A tree. There are lots and lots of things that fit this pattern. And we also need whatever it is that's fitting that pattern to have one of these fmap functions. So this is a function that takes a function from some A to some B, and one of these container types of that containing A's, and gives us back the same kind of container type containing the B's. So this should look pretty familiar. It's just like we looked at when we looked at the map signature, but we've got F here now because we're talking about these kind of things generically rather than specifically to lists. And so we can use this on lists. So we can fmap multiply by two function, now written in the section syntax rather than how we saw it before, over a list 1, 2, 3, and that gives us our result. But we can use that same fmap function on other functors as well. So if we fmap, say, the reverse function, just to reverse a string, over the IO action we get when we run getLine. So getLine just gets a single line of input from the user. And if you run that in GHCI, it'll wait for you to type in your line of input. And then we're going to actually be mapping that reverse over that, and when we get our result back, it's going to be reversed. So to return to the static path example, this example actually has fmap hidden away in it, but it's written in a funny syntax. You see this in Haskell a lot, we have these kind of things. So this is actually fmap written in infix form. So rather than preceding the arguments, it's now written between the arguments, an exact same type as what we saw. So we saw before what this expression resulted in. It results in a function that takes some maybe file path and gives us back a file path. And on the other side, we've got this call to a function looking up the environment variable, and that gives us an IO action that contains a maybe file path. So we want to actually apply that function to the maybe file path within that. How do we do that? We can use fmap. And that's actually what's going on here to finally return what we want from this function, which is the IO file path. So next up, the M word. So I think monads probably get a lot more attention than they really deserve. If you understood what I was talking about with functor, then this is really just a beefed up functor. In fact, monads are also functors. So again, we're talking about a structure, some container, if you like, or computational context that itself contains other values. And in this case, it's a different signature. It implements two particular functions, or there are other ways of defining it with three, but we'll go with two for now, that facilitate the chaining of computations. And that's it. Like, the big idea of this is just that it's a useful pattern, and like before, if we are able to abstract at this level, we're able to write code once for anything that happens to fit this pattern. And there are a lot of things that fit the monad pattern, and I guess that's why people go on about it. So let's have a look at its type class. So if we go and do info on monad, we're going to get some monad M. And so this M is a type constructor like the F we saw previously. And we've got two functions there, a return. So return is nothing like the kind of imperative return you might have seen, so just kind of disconnect that in your brain. And then the other thing with the funny symbols we've got there is we pronounce that bind, and this is an infix function. So again, if we were going to do this in Java, for those that know that syntax, it might look something like this. But again, this wouldn't actually compile in Java because we've got these M of Bs and M of As going on. So again, some kind of container or computational context that contains some other generic value, where that context could be, say, a list. List is in fact a monad, or it could be IO. IO is also a monad, or a whole number of other things. And that has these two particular functions. So to look at them a little bit more closely, so we've got return here. So this takes one of these generic types, whatever it's going to be, A, and it puts it into that monadic context, so putting it inside our shape. And the minimal context, in fact, that still yields that same result. And then we've also got this bind function, which looks a little bit more complicated there. So we're taking one of these monads of some type A. We're taking a function that takes one of those A's, whatever it is, and it returns a monad of some type B, and then gives us a monad of some type B. And this, hopefully, you might be thinking, oh, that looks kind of familiar. It's very similar to what we saw with fmap, only now, instead of just going to A to B, we're going A to M of B, and we flip the order. But other than that, same kind of signature. So let's have a look at a more concrete example, because I know it's hard to think abstractly about these things. So let's imagine now, looking at the list monad, we've got some list of strings, and we use this bind function and bind it to a little lambda I've created here that takes each string and runs a return on it, so putting it back up into the monad context. So in the case of a list, that would just be creating a single element list that then does an append with that string that's coming in. And so the result of that is going to be all the different combinations that we get. So the list monad is said to model non-determinism. So here's another example of actually chaining some of these things together, and that's where monads really tend to come to the fore. So we've now got the same list before, and we're doing a bind on a lambda, but inside that lambda, we've got another list, and we're doing another bind, and we've got nested in the middle here a function that's running the return, so putting it back in the list context on what you get when you append those two things together. And the result of this is going to be the cross product of those two lists that we've got. And if you think this kind of looks vaguely familiar, list comprehensions are something that we have in Haskell and a number of other languages. List comprehensions are really just syntactic sugar for this, for the list monad. So this is a good idea. It comes in handy a lot. And this is just one particular instance of a monad, to make it a bit more concrete. All of this stuff, though, when we're talking about MSA, there are many other things that fit this particular pattern. So the big idea is just that we have this useful pattern, and we can have this whole library of building block functions that we can write for things that have return and bind, so anything that fits that pattern, and write them once for anything. And that's really all it's about. So here's an example from the Wubble World app. So we've got a little function here to create an IO action to get a database connection, something very real world you want to do a lot, using two different functions there. So the type of this first one is that it returns us an IO action that gets some connect info, and we've got the connect function which expects one of these same connect infos, and that gives us back an IO action that gives us back our connection. How do we put them together? We use this handy bind function, which has the type that we've seen, and if we kind of line that up for what we're after, we see our M is IO, we're dealing with the IO monad, our A is a connect info, and our B is a connection. And when we run this, we get the final result which we want, which is an IO connection. So all the types are lining up for us here. The last topic I want to talk about is lens. So this is a data structure for doing getting and setting, kind of all in one. So a problem that you have in languages where immutability is the way that you're going is when you try to drill down into one of these immutable types and change something, there's often a lot of work that you have to do to then create the new one, wrapping up all those same values again. And it can be a little bit messy. There's kind of a bit of boilerplate. So lens is an elegant, concise, functional way for handling that problem and drilling down into these data types to do gets or sets. And this is actually quite an interesting area. There has been some advancements in Lens and how this stuff is done, even in the last few years. So it's actually kind of, yeah, an exciting, growing area, and we're getting better at doing this. So here's a here's an example of this Lens data type. So imagine we've got a get and a set. But actually, what it ends up looking like, because some smart people who know their maths came up with a way to put these together and handle a few of the other problems that arise, such as doing polymorphic updates, so doing these things where we actually want to change the type of something, and they came up with that, which I'm not going to talk through, but yeah, just be aware that so that's the kind of thing that you've got, a data structure that's handling gets and sets and doing some other useful things along the way. And within the Lens library in Haskell, we also have some other things, prisms, traversals, things, other things you might hear about to handle other problems, things like viewing and updating multiple values or dealing with the possible failure of when you try to drill down into a type and something's not actually there. So this is doing things, as you'll see in the next example, we're kind of doing what we can kind of do in object-oriented programming in a more imperative style, and then kind of going even beyond that to do things in a concise, functional, composable way, you know, maintaining all our type safety and all the goodness of FP. So here's a little example. I've got some data there. I haven't shown you the constructors for this, so you'll just have to imagine, but we've got some dogs that have names, and names have a first name and a last name component. We've got cats that have an arch enemy, of course, set to dog. And then we have a mouse, which has some kind of food that it likes to eat. So using lenses, we can grab a cat. And this little caret dollar thing is the getter function that we're using. And then the lenses are this arch enemy name and first name. So it looks, as you see, kind of very object-oriented. But you can kind of drill down using that. So we go down and we figure out what the arch enemy is. And then we can drill down into the arch enemy and grab its name. And we can drill down into that and grab the first name component and actually get the result that we want in the end. So that's the kind of code you might see using lenses. And we also do things like updating, even polymorphic updates. So the cat, the type of the arch enemy that it has is actually part of its type, but this isn't a problem. We can handle this, so we can set its arch enemy to something else to get, and that works fine, thanks to lenses and all the goodness we've got going on there. And we had a lens, actually, an example we've already seen. That's was hiding away there. We've got our getter and the name lens. So if you didn't understand all of that, don't worry. Basically, a lot of people, smart people, have come up and done all this maths so that we don't have to, and we get a nice, elegant, concise, functional way of doing these kind of tasks without having to resort to kind of dirty, imperative kind of stuff. So I realised that was probably quite intense, a kind of whirlwind tour. Do not worry at all if you did not follow every detail. That's fine, that's to be expected. But I hope what you've seen is that there are some reasons here why functional programming is worth taking a look at. So we looked at referential transparency, and we saw that you can get the ability to reason about your code, which makes it easier to test, easier to run in parallel, easier to avoid whole classes of bugs. This is all useful stuff. We looked at higher order functions. So we saw how you can write code in neat, reusable kind of chunks using this functional style. Help us write more concise code using higher order functions and things like closure and lens. We saw how we're able to abstract at a higher level to avoid code duplication with things like functor and monad, and there are many other things like that out there. And we saw with things like lens and monad that we can kind of leverage these ideas that smart people have figured out. To do our code in a better way. So none of these ideas are new. They've been around for a very long time, but I hope I've shown you that they can be useful, and they are actually more accessible than you might think. When you've learned to solve problems in a particular way, it can be challenging to shift your mindset to a new way of thinking, but that doesn't mean it's not worth doing so. And it's not really difficult, it's just unfamiliar. You have to put in a bit of effort to really learn these concepts. You'll have to go out and do your homework and experience these things for yourself. But I think it's very much worth doing so. And if you would like to do that, I've got a whole bunch of resources to get you started. If I had to just pick out one there, I'd probably say the Learn Your Haskell for Great Good book is a really good place to get started. You can read it online for free, and they're also selling it here if you like hard copies. And if you would like these slides and to follow any of these links or have a look at the Haskell app that I've showed, you'll find them at decoder.codemiller.com. Thank you very much for having me.